As I was singing those songs in both services, that verse in 2 Corinthians that I mentioned about how as we gaze upon his glory, that we are transformed. This thought came to me, and I want you to think about that. I don't know about you, but this week I felt some areas of my life I really want God to transform. I need transformation in some areas of my life. And so many times I think we think that our transformation is our project. And guys, that's not how we are transformed. We can't transform ourselves. The key to transformation is by watching, by beholding his glory. And as we behold his glory, we are changed. And so as I was singing those songs, I was thinking, God, I need transformation. And so I am singing with all of my heart. I am praising with all of my heart. I am gazing upon your glory with all of my heart, because that is how badly I need transformed. And so here's a thought. I think that the degree to which we press into God's presence is to the degree we realize our need for transformation. So those of us who press in hard are those of us that are most aware of our need for him to change us. So can I encourage our church to be a church that presses in worship, that says, God, we are desperate for change in our life. We are desperate for transformation. You are the only source of our transformation. And so when we sing, when we praise, when we pray, when we study, when we look at the face of God, let us look at it intently. Let us look at it with a desperation for his changing power in our life. Can I get an amen to that? Amen. And the next time we're singing together, I want you to sing with your heart, because you say, God, I need your change. I need what only you can do. I came here to meet you today. I came here to meet you today. I came to this place with the express purpose of meeting with my God. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning. Brad's wound up today. It's been a fun week for us, and so we're excited about the message today, and glad you're here. Let me give you two things. I've been asked to remind you about the membership class. If you want to be a part of the church here, be a member here, you can sign up there at the join the community table. And then also, I am being a billboard today. If you've not signed up for the 5K run, I'm modeling Vanna White here. You like that? Okay. I know, pretty nasty, isn't it? It's going to be this Saturday, and it's also a join the community and table. So if you've not signed up for the 5K, it's going to be an amazing day. It's going to end up that night. What's the name of the hotel? Westin?
Yeah.
The Westin. And so it's going to be a really, really neat time. Want to say hi to Walt right here. Walt, thank you so much for being a part of us today. We always enjoy guests. And Callie, where are you at? Wave to me. I'm sorry you got to deal with him again. Is she one of your students?
No, she. I work for her.
Oh, I like that better. So you can just correct him right in the middle of the service. Yeah. We'll give it to you, okay? But she's from Lincoln University. So glad that you're here. Billy and Candace, wave to me. Glad you guys are here. They drive every Sunday all the way from California just to attend our church.
That's amazing.
I'm lying like a dog. No, they're just visiting today, but I'm glad you guys are here. Well, I pray you've had an amazing week, and we're going to pray and get started today. We're starting a new series in Lead, and wasn't last week a lot of fun?
Amen.
Wasn't that cool? And we were all together as a family in the gymnasium, and the representation of everybody that's working in our ministry, just a great, great week. So we're excited to kick this off today. Let's have a word of prayer and we'll start. Father, so many people have come from so many different situations this week, Father, good, bad. Just yesterday, Father, doing a funeral for a dear family, and Father, just the pain that they're going through right now, this temporary separation that we talk about. Father, as someone passes on to be with you, Father, temporarily we are separated. But Father, I pray for that family right now. They are just in mourning as they have lost a dear mother. And Father, I pray that you would bless them. But Father, as we gather together today, again, just so many different things that have happened this week. Some of us are excited. Some of us are mad. Some of us are bitter. Some of us are just struggling. And Father, some of us are just here. And so Father, we need your spirit to empower us. And Father, as we open your word, we pray you lead us and guide us. in Jesus' name. Amen. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you. Be seated. Grab your Bibles today. And as we start our series, Lead Forward. Sorry, junior high, you can be dismissed. Deaf class, you can be dismissed. Anybody that wants to catch a football game, you can stay right where you are. Okay. Just kidding. No, I'm really not, but as we start a new series, we've entitled it Lead Forward. Okay? Ken and Sherry, you guys can't sit on the back row. You guys are like always in the front. Oh, okay, that's fine. There's a whole row over here. But I know you're normally on that side. You guys are trying to mess with me, aren't you? I like that. That's okay. That's okay. We've entitled our series Lead Forward for this specific reason. I hear people say all the time, Eddie, I realize that I'm supposed to love. Got that. Love God, love others. I realize that I'm supposed to learn the Bible, and I'm good with that. But when you get to the lead stage, forget it. It's not me. And so what I'll do is I'll just kind of stay over here, and I'll stay in the love area and the learn area. But the leading, that's only for pastors and for other people like that, not me. Also, I've heard this. I would like to lead, but you know what? With all the stuff I've got going on, in fact, not only that, the stuff in my past, there's no way that I could lead. So we've entitled this entire year to Lead Forward. Simply means from this point on. Now, what we want to do today, though, is we kind of want to unpack and ask the question, what is leadership? So let me ask you the question, what do you think of when you hear these three words? And I'm going to ask you to talk to me. When you hear lead, when you hear leader, when you hear leadership. Now, I had to pick this picture because when I was a kid, if you ever saw this movie, Patton was just a leader, wasn't he? Just a man's man. He was tough. He was decisive. Just awesome. So as a kid growing up, if you would have asked me, who's a leader? George Patton. Awesome. Strong. So let me ask you. What do you think of? Because again, for a lot of people, when we bump up against this word lead, we kind of disqualify ourselves because we're not like that. So talk to me. What do you think of? Here we go. Not everybody at once. Setting an example. So whenever you hear lead or leader, you think of setting an example. That's good. Somebody else. Someone who serves. Okay. It's good. Yes. Hey, this guy right here has got some great answers, okay? So I got to hear this one. What you got? Huh? Peace? Police. Good. He's always got some good stuff, so I'm always... Yes. Someone who loves? You really think a leader is someone who loves? Is this what you think of? You're awesome, dude.
Someone to follow.
Okay.
A teacher?
It's good. Yes. Someone who makes the tough choices? It's good. Somebody else. Someone always in the last line takes care of his people first. You guys are good. Somebody who walks the walk. Okay. You see, because again, there's kind of this understanding that there is this group of people called leaders, and then I fall in the other category. So there's two different groups out there. There are those that lead. There are those that... Is that true? But biblically, is that true? We're going to ask. Somebody else, what do you think of?
Servant.
Good. See, I always thought of tough, decisive, charismatic personality. And I can remember as a kid growing up, I'm like, that's not me. In fact, here's what kind of my view was. Great leaders like this. You would study in history class, and you'd hear these amazing speeches that Winston Churchill would give during World War II, and Abraham Lincoln, and Martin Luther King Jr. Or maybe even kind of modern day. Of course, if you like football, you know Peyton Manning. They call him the coach of coaches. I've heard him say that. And he's a player, but he coaches everybody. They said that sometimes that Peyton will even coach the other team. And they take it, because he's just that kind of a guy. He's that kind of a leader. Mother Teresa, Gandhi, you see these two guys here that have changed our whole world and how we think. That's just a whole nother level to create the computer and everything that they've done. Go on in this top left corner over here. My dad was from Indiana, so there was nobody greater than Bobby Knight, the great basketball coach. Michael Jordan. And so what happens sometimes is whenever we come to this statement and we say we all need to be leaders, what we do very quickly is that we have this image in our mind and we step back and go, I can't do that. And so we disqualify ourselves from leading. So what we want to do today is we want to start the process of teaching what it means to lead. Because that's the question. What does it mean to lead? What I'm going to do, I'm going to show you a clip. Do you ever see the movie Rudy? You see that movie? Okay. In this clip, I want to show you a great example of what we mean to lead. In this clip, his friend is encouraging him to go and get his dream. His dream is to be a football player at the University of Notre Dame. So notice this clip and watch how his friend leads him. Watch this.
What is today?
Friday.
No, I mean the day.
August 23rd.
And that is?
My birthday.
22 big ones.
Oh, Pete, it's starting to go by too fast.
Well, I know I didn't have time to wrap it, but, you know. Go ahead.
Oh. You shouldn't have, Pete.
No, I know. I was in Gary and I saw it in the surplus store and I said, that's gotta be yours.
This is unbelievable. Pete, I don't know how I'm ever gonna thank you. How's it look?
You were born to wear that jacket.
Do you know that era? Is the only head coach in Notre Dame history that encourages walk-on players?
You probably know more about that team than half the players.
I can't wait to get there. Guess how much money I have saved up.
What? 20. 30, 80, 50.
$1,000.
Oh! That's a good start.
The only one who ever took me serious, Pete.
Well, you know what my dad always said. Having dreams is what makes life tolerable.
So, question. Is that leadership? You see in this clip, this friend is ever nudging him a little closer to his dream. Okay? What we want to do today is we want to define exactly what Jesus was talking about when he declared to every one of us to make disciples, to lead. In fact, John Maxwell says, leadership is influence, nothing more, nothing less. You see here in this clip, he said, you know what, Pete, you're the only one who ever encouraged me. You know, it's a situation here where this best friend is doing something for what reason? Somebody know? Because he loves his friend. And he is nudging him ever closer to what his dream is. The dictionary says, or Webster says, influence is the capacity to have an effect on the character, development, or behavior of someone or something. We said this last week in our State of the Church, that we want to be a community that connects people who are disconnected from God. So as we begin to unpack this, we want to show you that leadership is simply connecting people who are disconnected from God. Now, take your Bibles, and we're going to see from the very beginning in John chapter 1 how right from the beginning this is put in motion, this is put in place, and this is just awesome. In John chapter 1, verse 35, it says, one of the two who heard John, talking about John the Baptist, who declared that this is the Lamb of God, if you remember that story, one of the two who heard John speak and follow Jesus was Andrew. Now, very quickly, though, I want you to notice who this next person is. There's this new follower of Christ by the name of Andrew, and he's going to go get his brother. Does anybody know who his brother is? Read it. Who is Simon Peter? The guy that we've been talking about for the last 4 months, who wrote 1 Peter and 2 Peter. Isn't that cool? So you're seeing a little bit at the beginning that Andrew was the one who went and got Peter. And for the last 4 months, we've seen who this amazing guy is. But here we go. So one of the two who heard John speak and followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. Verse 41. Andrew here, he first found his own brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which means Christ. He first found who? His group of influence, or his sphere of influence. He first goes to his brother, the one who he cares for, the one who he loves. Not a complete stranger. Stop it with the strangers. Although we need to reach to them, let's look at those that we love. Our friends, our family. Just like back at this clip, he is encouraging him. Leadership is simply influence. So we see this here. It says he first found his own brother, Simon, and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which means Christ. Verse 42, what does he do here? Does he take his brother off to the side and give him this deep dissertation of what it means to find the Messiah and the promise of the Messiah and all of the prophecies that go along with it? Is that what he did? No. In fact, you know, a lot of us, we kind of disqualify ourselves right there because it's like, what am I going to say? What does Andrew say? He just brings him to Jesus. That's all. You see, for so many of us who are followers of Christ, we have got so far in our walk, and this one right here scares us to death. Because we have this concept that to be a leader for God, I have to be a pastor or a missionary. I have to be some kind of a great orator. Right from the beginning, we see it's not true. But he says he brought him to Jesus, and Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas," which means Peter. So as we begin to, as we continue to unpack that, that's what we mean by lead. Again, take out the pictures, although they were great leaders. Take out this huge group of people that we have put on a pedestal, and let's look from Scripture. Look at this next one here in verse 43. Verse 43 is Brad continues.
Okay, so I just love this text. Look what happens next. My friend is back, the fly.
Okay, do you guys have like flies at your house everywhere now?
It's like the plagues of
Egypt.
Okay,
yeah, we have like demonic flies up here, and they're like all over the place. So if you see a swatting and stuff, just deal with it, because there's one that's circling bad.
Could be it could be a drone. I don't know. Anyway. Yeah,
drone.
Verse 43. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. Now, we don't know what influenced this decision. I don't know why Jesus all of a sudden said, "I'm going to go to Galilee." But he decides to go to Galilee. Obviously, Peter and Andrew are now in tow following Jesus to Galilee. It says to us in this text that this is actually where Peter and Andrew were from. They go to the town of Bethsaida there. In verse 44, it talks about that. And so they're headed back to Peter and Andrew's hometown. Now, Peter and Andrew lived not in Bethsaida. They were born there, but they actually, Mark tells us, they lived in Capernaum. So Jesus is headed back to Galilee, the area of Galilee, and to the particular town of Bethsaida. And I want to pick out, I want to show you this. It says, he found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." So there's a seeking out on Jesus's part. Jesus seeks this guy, Philip, out, and he invites Philip to follow him. Now, let's talk about Philip for a second. I love this guy. If you kind of take the rest of the book of John and try to, you know, pick out what we can learn about Philip, he appears three more times in the book of John. I want to kind of go through what we kind of know about this guy who Jesus sought out. The next time we see Philip is, it's at the scene in John 6 where there's the feeding of the 5,000. Do you remember that scene? And Jesus kind of knows what he's going to do, but he tries to put a little, a little pressure on his disciples to try to figure out the problem. There's all this this massive crowd, and he says, "Hey guys, why don't you feed them?" And I mean, there's this, you know, desperation, and then Philip kind of speaks out, and he says, Jesus, 200 days wages couldn't feed this crowd. So he's a little like exasperated. He's a little, maybe the sky is falling, kind of a little like, just intense about it. Like, oh my gosh, Jesus, are you kidding me? You know, so we see a little bit about who he is in John 6. The next time we see him is in John 12. And in John 12, some Greek people have come to see Jesus. Now, think about this. Philip is one of the disciples of Jesus, right? He's one of his followers. And so they come to Philip and they say, hey, you know, Philip, we'd like to see Jesus. Well, Philip doesn't know what to do. So he finds Andrew. Andrew, there's all these people that want to see Jesus. And Andrew's like, well, let's go bring him to Jesus, right? And so, you know, it's like almost like Philip just doesn't quite have a lot of, you know how. He's really, you know, kind of a regular guy. He's maybe a guy with ordinary means, not super extraordinary person. The last time we see him in the book of John is at the Last Supper. And if you guys remember that scene, Jesus has been saying things like, where I'm going, you can't come. I'm about to leave. And the disciples are kind of scared and freaking out. And there's, you know, questions about what does he mean? He's going where we can't go. And what does he mean by this? And then Philip kind of speaks up and he says, Jesus, just show us the Father and that will be enough for us. And it's like that awkward question, you know, that kind of hangs in the air and everyone all of a sudden just stops and looks at him like, Philip, why? And Jesus says to Philip, remember, he says, Philip, I've been with you for 3 years, man. I mean, are you really asking me that? If you've seen me, you've seen who?
The Father,
right? And I'm glad Philip asked that because that's a beautiful, like, text from Scripture. But it's kind of one of those, like, Philip, come on, man. I mean, we know he's the representation of the Father. We know this. I mean, this is, we get that. But Philip was maybe a little ordinary. And here's what I like about this. I like that Jesus came to Bethsaida looking to find a very ordinary man.
Amen.
I like that because here, you know what that tells me? That tells me that Jesus doesn't need extraordinary people to do extraordinary things. Guys, Jesus can use ordinary people with ordinary resources, amen, ordinary gifts, ordinary abilities to do extraordinary things with. Amen. Can I get an amen to that?
Amen.
Anyone else in here feel like sometimes that there are just some things you're just not able to do for God and God's kingdom because you just aren't gifted enough?
That's right.
Amen. You're just not elite enough. You weren't at the top of the class. You were kind of more in the middle of the pack,
right,
you know? And sometimes I think our enemy can say, unless you have these extraordinary gifts, you're really of no use for God. And I think Philip refutes that. Can I get an amen to that? Isn't
amen.
That awesome?
Mm-hmm.
God says, I'm coming to Bethsaida to look for a very vanilla guy to give him a really extraordinary purpose.
That's right.
And so what does this really ordinary guy do, right? So that's who Philip is. What does he do? Well, look what he does. Verse 45. Philip finds Nathanael. Now, we don't know what the relationship is between Nathanael and Philip. In the relationship between Andrew and Peter, it specifically says that they're brothers.
That's right.
So I'm inclined to think that if they were brothers, it would have said so. They may have been. I'm not sure. But at least they're friends, okay? So there's a relationship here. And so Philip has just been invited by Jesus to follow him. And so Philip goes and finds his friend, Nathanael. Watch this interchange. Look what happens. Verse 45, Philip finds Nathanael and says to him, we have found him of whom Moses and the law and the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. I mean, so Philip comes bursting in, you know, wherever Nathanael was, and just with this giant declaration, like, dude, we found the Messiah, man. Like, come on, you know, and here's Nathanael's response. You got to picture this, right? I hope I've painted a picture of who Philip may have been, right? So if you have a friend like Philip coming excited about something, you know, you might respond like Nathanael, like, Philip, okay, man, last week it was, you just figured out, you know, you invented the internet or something, I don't know, you know, and this week you found the Messiah, I mean, Philip, you know, could anything good come out of Nazareth, man? Come on, man, what are you doing? Now, look at this ordinary guy.
That's right.
Who's just excited that he met Jesus. Mm-hmm. Look what he does. He says, come and see. Now, look what he doesn't do. And Eddie kind of alluded to this. He doesn't feel this pressure. And I really want you to follow this, guys. He doesn't feel this pressure to try to defend Jesus. He doesn't feel this pressure to try to create an apologetic argument for why Jesus fits this profile of the Messiah. He doesn't feel this pressure to kind of reach into his intellectual toolbox, of which there may not have been that many tools, you with me, right? And to try to come up with a reason for Jesus being the Messiah. He doesn't do any of that. And I think that's what stops some of us.
That's right.
We feel like we don't have the training, that's we right. don't have the ability, we can't get the words out right, and so we just keep our mouth shut.
That's right.
Friends, listen to me. Philip is not introducing Nathanael to a set of beliefs. He's introducing Nathanael to a person. Yeah. Jesus isn't just a set of propositions that you kind of wrap your mind around. He's a person that you begin a relationship with. Can amen. I get an amen to that
amen.
One?
Amen.
And friends, all Philip had to do is just get Jesus close to him.
That's right.
He just had to get his friend within proximity. He just had to bring Nathanael, who is far away from Jesus, and get him into the room with Jesus. And the rest of it would what? Just take care of itself. Mm-hmm. Isn't that awesome? Mm-hmm. So let's look at what happens. I just love this. I'm not even to the good part yet, guys. Look at this next part. Verse 47. Jesus sees Nathanael coming toward him. So here comes Philip. Here comes the skeptic, right? Nathanael, okay, who are y'all excited about this week, Philip, you know? I'll come and see your Messiah, you know? And here comes Nathanael. And Jesus says, look what he reads, behold. In other words, hey, looky there. It's kind of like, you know, substandard English. Hey, looky there. A real dude.
That's right.
Obviously not in the text, but this is what he's saying. A real Israelite, mm-hmm. a genuine Israelite. This, in fact, is a high compliment. He's calling him a true Israelite. An Israelite, indeed, is how our ESV translates that. Mm-hmm. It can be translated as a genuine Israelite or a true Israelite. See, Israel had a high calling that God gave to that nation. A nation was called to represent God to this world, mm-hmm. to be a light on a hill and a salt of the earth. To be God's people that would influence this world. And yet, unfortunately, many Israelites did not fulfill that calling.
That's right.
So in a sense, they were not true Israelites, right? But Jesus is saying about Nathanael that Nathanael is indeed a true Israelite. He is someone who's representing to the world God, and he's doing it without hypocrisy. It says here, in whom there is no deceit. In other words, he is a genuine guy. He's the true blue. He's someone who, someone said earlier, who walks the walk, not just talks the talk. Nathanael is genuine to his core. And Jesus points that out about Nathanael. He says, you are a genuine Israelite. You're a seeker of the Most High God, and you represent him to the world. That's what he's saying. Mm-hmm. So Nathanael says, what I think any of us would say is, how do you know me? Like, how do you know? You don't know me. You don't know me, right? And then Jesus just knocks him over.
That's right.
This next interchange might not seem like a lot, but I'm going to try to unpack it. And I pray it hits you like it hit me. Look what happens next. Jesus answers him, before Philip called you, before he called you, when you were underneath the fig tree, I saw you. As I said, at first glance, you might not think that's very significant. Okay, you know, he says he saw him before he was under a fig tree. But I want us now to kind of put this whole thing into perspective. Jesus has identified Nathanael as a genuine Israelite, one who genuinely seeks after God. One who, if you're a first century Israelite, you are earnestly waiting for the redemption of Israel. You are like Anna the prophetess and Simeon the prophet in the book of Luke, and you are waiting for God's deliverance to come. You are waiting for the Messiah. And he says he saw him under a fig tree. Now, fig trees in Palestine were probably one of the only places for good shade. In fact, it's known from other cultural works from the time that fig trees were normal places where people would gather together and sometimes read scripture or by themselves meditate and pray. And so it is not, you know, too much of a stretch to kind of say that a situation like this was probably what was going on. That Nathanael, this true Israelite, was seeking God. in an intense way underneath a fig tree, maybe that very day. And maybe he had an intense time with God there as a genuine Israelite, asking for God's deliverance, asking for God's redemption to come. And it just so happened that just after that experience, this guy, this crazy friend of his, this guy who's prone to maybe being a little bit, you know, maybe not rational or something, comes walking up and says, Nathaniel, I want you to meet some guy. I met him. He's the Messiah. And Nathaniel, in all of his skepticism, comes face to face with this teacher from Nazareth. And you know what he does? He disarms all of Nathaniel's skepticism with a simple statement.
That's right.
And here's what it is. Nathaniel, I saw you. I saw you when you were underneath the tree. I heard your prayer. You see, guys, here's the other part I wanted to bring out. You see, Christianity isn't just a body of truths to believe in. It's a person to meet. Remember I said that? And sometimes the way God confirms his presence in your life is in ways that only make sense to you, in a subjective way, in a private way that really ministers to you. God sometimes goes around your defenses and he ministers to you in a particular way that only you get and only you are moved. Here's the thing, I don't know about you, but I've had many experiences in my life when I've been desperate for God and someone has said something that just hit me in a way that communicated love from God to me in such a personal way that I can't even explain it. It's as if God confirms, Brad, I've heard your prayers. Brad, I've been there. I'm answering you now, and I'm answering you in a way that only you can hear it, and in an experience only you can detect. And so it's like this. It's like God is coming to you and saying, I was there when you were praying under that fig tree. You see, friends, If I can get my friend Eddie just in the room with Jesus, Jesus will do the rest. He'll minister to Eddie. He'll go around his defenses. He'll go around his skepticism, and he'll communicate love to Eddie in such a way, such a powerful way. Right. It'll only make sense to him, mm-hmm. but it'll undo his entire heart. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you guys, if we had time and we could share this, and I hope I'm unpacking this well, but that there are just experiences where you're just in this tough situation. You've had this intense time of seeking after God because your life is just crushed with problems. And then all of a sudden, there's this person, and he just says something that is a little offhand. And you're just like, you did not just say that just now. I can't believe you just said that. That is exactly what I needed to what? Hear. God is communicating his love to me in such a personal way. I was talking to some friends this week, and one of them said this, and I know this has been said before, but what a great reminder. They said that, you know, our relationship with God, it's personal, mm-hmm. but it's not private. It's personal, but it's not private. And what that means is, guys, we have this relationship with God that is very personal. And God communicates love to me in ways, maybe not to you, but we corporately share it. And so as a Christian, I know that this loving God is trying to reach all of you. And here's my question. Every one of you have a fig tree moment in your life. What is your fig tree moment? What is that place in your life where you are just kind of all by yourself and God just met you in a powerful way? So how does this work out? Let's look at the end. Verse 49, so Nathaniel says, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. So get this. Jesus goes around those defenses, goes around that skepticism, talks about that fig tree moment that Nathaniel had earlier, and that convinces Nathaniel of Jesus' position as king. Well, this isn't the only time Nathaniel's mentioned in the book of John. He's mentioned at the very end of the book of John as well. So we don't read much about Nathaniel all the way till the end, but you know what he sees at the very end of the book of John? You remember that fishing trip that Peter took when he didn't know what else to do after Jesus had risen from the dead and he was kind of waiting for more instructions? Guess who's in the boat with Peter, along with about six other disciples? Nathaniel's there. The Bible says specifically Nathaniel is there. And so Nathaniel was a witness to that beautiful morning when Jesus is on the shore of Galilee, the Sea of Galilee, and he says, hey guys, catch any fish? Nathaniel's in the boat when that event happens. Isn't that amazing? Mm-hmm. So I want you to pull this together now. We have this ordinary guy, Philip, who encounters Jesus. He doesn't have many arguments. He doesn't have many resources, but he has a friend named Nathaniel who's kind of a skeptic.
Right.
He introduces Jesus to Nathaniel, and Jesus does the rest. And Nathaniel becomes a bold proclaimer of the resurrected Jesus, mm-hmm. a powerful influence. And hit this slide for me. And this is this is a great picture. One lighted torch serves to light another. And guys, that's all we are as disciples of Jesus. Hopefully you're a lit up torch. Mm-hmm. And that's all you're doing. You're just getting closer to another guy and you're just leaning over and letting that fire just spread. Mm-hmm. That's all it is. Mm-hmm. You don't have to be a great orator, speaker, pastor, apologetic, guru, a philosopher. Just be yourself. Use your influence and point them to Jesus.
Amen. This is a statement we were talking about the other day. Kingdom leadership is simply the intentional use of one's influence for the purpose of building God's kingdom. Brian, let me ask you a question. What if Philip would have brought Nathaniel and Nathaniel would have said, psh, don't want it?
I think Philip did all he could.
Is that Philip's problem? Huh? Is that Philip's problem? You know, the great thing about it is, and Brad's heard me say this so many times, in situations, you know what? It's not my problem. That's God's problem. What God has called us to do is just to simply bring people to him. He does the rest. We can't change people. We can't fix people. All we do is proclaim. Look at this last part, and we're going to wrap it up here. In Matthew chapter 5, in the same way, in fact, if we could kind of turn this around and say, calm, in the same way, let your light shine. Shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Let your light. Now, I have to be honest here. I kind of put that in parentheses. I've been struggling with this all week long because if you've been in church any length of time, you have heard this preached over and over and over again. In fact, if you remember what comes right before this, this is the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is calling us to be the salt and the light, remember? And then after he talks about that, you know, he uses the illustration, a city that's set on a hill can't be hidden. No person in their right mind would light a candle in a dark house and then put it under a bushel. Nobody in their right mind would do that. And so then he makes a statement, in the same way, let your light shine. So I'm like, what is your light? Ever think about it? You see, I looked at some of the commentaries and it didn't make any sense because some of the commentaries were like, your light is your good works. I'm like, okay, that makes no sense. Let your good works shine so they can see your good works. That's kind of stupid. What is he talking about? Because again, sometimes in scripture, we can read something, we just kind of jump over it, like, okay, what is the light? What is he talking about? And then as we begin to kind of unpack this, it was just kind of really neat. For the last 2 years, we have said and made a statement that if we don't love and if we don't learn, we will never
lead.
It's really neat that when he says, let your light shine, and we know this, and I can't totally describe this today, but we know what he's talking about here. It is simply the Spirit of God manifesting himself through us.
Mm-hmm. Amen. That's good.
Let your light shine. If I'm not loving and learning, is there going to be a light? See, that's what's kind of happened in our church, is that we kind of don't take these two serious, and then all of a sudden we'll have these big days, and we're like, okay, let's all go lead, and we're like, I don't really want to, and it's hard, because the light's kind of dim. The light has been optional. Mm-hmm. We've not done what Jesus said was the greatest commandment, love God, love others. Love God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. And so when it comes to this lead, we're kind of like, you know, in fact, whenever we see this, let your light so shine that people may see your good works, you're like, oh. So what is the light? Church, it has nothing to do with you. It has everything to do with him. You see, again, whenever we, and this is what my desire is that when we go through this lead stage, we really understand that Christianity, all of this stuff, mm-hmm. is all about him. It is his thing. It's not ours. We're just allowed to be a part of it.
Amen.
If it works, it's on him. If it doesn't, it's on him. Do you get it? Mm-hmm. That's why the Christian life ought to be the biggest party ever. As these guys, come see Jesus. I don't like him. Okay. He's really cool. Don't want to. Okay. But what are you supposed to be? A person who just lets it shine.
Amen.
Because it's who I am. It's not something that's been manufactured. It's just who I am. When I'm loving him, when I'm learning from him, guess what will naturally happen? I'll be telling others about him.
That's really good.
Brett, hit this next one. Mm-hmm. Let me throw you a couple of things out here to really make it clear and then we're done. When we say that leadership is influence, Mom, the greatest influence that you can do, or the greatest influence that you can be in your life is on your children. The statistics are still clear. The greatest influence in a child's life is their mother and their father. Mom, listen to me. The influence that you have on little Jimmy here, okay, is awesome. And you know what? Teach him about Mother Goose. That's awesome, but that's great. But look, teach him about Jesus. And not just teach him about Jesus, model Jesus to him.
Amen. That's right.
Why? Leverage your influence for the kingdom of God. Fathers, wow. The impact that you have, the latest statistics I saw, 90% of men in prison were men that did not have a father in the home. Men, the natural influence that you have, leverage it for the kingdom of God. In the way you talk, in the way you care, the way you love. Coworker. You know what? Great leadership is this. Everybody that you bump into, you point them to Christ. How do I do that? How do I point people to Christ? Do I have to wear a Christian t-shirt every place I go? Go, hey, look here. Is that what I do? No. Do I carry a sign around? No. Every time I get an opportunity, do I say, if you died today, do you know where you spent? No. You know what the greatest thing you can do, the greatest leadership that you can have for the kingdom of God is love. Everybody that you bump into, love them. Kind word, kind action. Be helpful, be considerate. Ready for this one? For cotton picking sakes, be who you are. Do you realize that's exactly what Jesus is teaching? Because remember what he said? You're the salt. You're the light. That's who you are. Be who you are. But we've allowed our culture. We've allowed our finances. We've allowed our drama to cover up our light.
You know, Eddie, my little girl said something to me yesterday. She goes, Daddy, you know it's really hard. I go, what's that? To be nice to someone who's not nice to you. I guess there's some little boogers in her class, of which I'm sure she is one, you know. And she's just wrestling through that, but she knows. Mm-hmm. She knows that that's what we're called to be, is to not love conditionally upon right. If someone's nice.
Right.
Yeah, but to love anyway.
Mm-hmm. So we lead in that way. Classmates, family members, anybody we bump into. Why? Why? Who are you? Natalie, who are you? You're salt and you're light. So if I bump into somebody and I'm salt and light, guess what's going to happen? There's going to be major influence and impact in their life.
Right.
Am I right?
That's good.
So as believers, we just bump into people. When that guy cuts you off and flips you off, flip him back. Jesus loves you. Okay? Look at everybody. I've done that one before. But when that coworker is driving you crazy, oh, opportunity. Opportunity to do what? To point him to Christ. You know what's going to jack him up more than anything else? Not to cuss him out. That's what the normal person does. You know what salt and light does? You're right. Sorry. See, everybody we bump into, we have a leadership or lead opportunity. This right here, again, we want to be a community that simply connects people who are disconnected to God. And I promise you, 99.9% of people are not going to be turned to God with a sign that says turn or burn. Would you agree?
Right.
So if we're going to connect people to God, Jesus is teaching simply be who you are.
Amen.
And as you bump into people, knowing that we are salt and light, all that we do is constantly, when we have the opportunity, pointing back to Christ. Because I promise you, if you bump into people often enough, and they see in you an unnormal characteristic, and they keep bumping into you, and you keep responding in a way that's not normal, I guarantee you, we live in Vegas, I bet my life on it, that one day they're going to come to you and say, you know what, can I talk to you? Something different about you, and I'm... Let your light shine. Make sense? First Sunday, you have 51 to go. We're going to learn to lead. Father, we love you. Father, we praise you. And Father, as Brad and I have prayed so often, help us, Father, to do what we cannot do. Father, we can't teach anybody anything apart from you. Jesus, you made it so clear that apart from you, we can do nothing. And Father, we know we can't. So Father, today I pray that your Spirit would be so mighty in this room. Father, that there would be this understanding that every time we bump up against our spouse, Father, that if anybody ought to experience your presence, it ought to be our spouse, our children, our friends, our co-workers. And Father, I pray today that we would not be a church that tries to manufacture this. Father, if we try to manufacture this, it's going to be a lot of frustrated, bitter, religious, yucky people. Father, I pray that your Spirit would be so mighty in our life that it would just be a natural reaction, as drinking water, as eating food, just a natural reaction that we brag on our kids, we're nice to our friends. The Father, that we would be about your kingdom. Father, teach us what it means to lead in your way. Father, that we represent you well. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, church, we love you today. And if you're visiting, God bless you. Thank you so much for being a part of our church. If you have any questions or like to talk, Brad and I will be right over here. In fact, if you are a first-time guest, we have a special gift for you. But if you have any questions, hear me before you run. If you have any questions, if you're on that journey that you're trying to figure it out, Brad and I would love to speak with you. We have a number of people around here that would love to speak with you about your journey. And so again, thank you so much for being a part of the church. We have a number of areas, membership, the 5K, all of the things to sign up for in the back. God bless you. Have an amazing week. You're dismissed.
I've got to tell you, it's just occurred to me what the student body has been chanting for the last 2 or 3 minutes. It's the name Rooter. Dan Rooter. A walk-on senior, subject of a future article in yesterday's student newspaper, The Observer. After toiling for 2 years at Carnegie Field.
Go get it, kid!